Thanks to all of you for coming today. It's my pleasure to chair the or moderate this morning session, which is about putting practical lessons into action. So we're going to hear from a series of four speakers. The first, Laura Whiteley Binder, I've known for 16 years now, I think, since she was a student in public policy at University of Washington, and she joined the Climate Impacts Group shortly after that. And she's been very effective at bridging this gap between science and action. And she's along the way become very well versed in the science and also in how to help communities, organizations, and individuals understand and adapt to climate variability and change. So she's very involved in that sort of boundary and communicating climate impacts and risks to decision makers. So we'll start off with Laura.
And I can actually thank Phil for getting involved in this work as a result of a presentation he gave in class. So it's those little things that you do that you don't realize are going to have an impact on somebody's life. So hold on, let me just get going here. Okay, so thank you all for coming this morning. And my job today is just to give you a quick 10-minute primer on adapting to climate change. And I know that for many of you, you're aware of what it is, and so I'm not going to kind of belabor all the various steps, but I do want to just kind of touch across some of the different aspects of adapting to climate change and talk about some of the other issues that may come up in that process that will tie in well, I think, with our case studies. So in general, when we're talking about adaptation, we're talking about reducing risks and creating resilience to climate impacts for human and natural systems. And conceptually, that can be a tough nut to crack. I mean, it's a simple statement, but when you start thinking about what does that mean, it can get rather overwhelming. You know, where do you start? How do you do this? Adaptation planning, in effect, helps us crack that nut. It gives us that roadmap. It helps us go through a process of identifying our risks associated with climate change and starting to identify different options for dealing with those risks, as well as your implementation pathways, your strategies for acting to reduce those risks. Now, it's worth noting that there are several different terms that are now being used to describe this concept of reducing climate risks and increasing your resilience to climate change. And you'll see in the literature, or you'll hear people talk about, or you'll see documents that refer to not only adaptation planning, but also climate preparedness planning, climate resilience planning, climate risk reduction. I have the tomato there. It's kind of the tomato thing. These are all very similar concepts, just different labels for essentially the same activity. There are perhaps nuances, and I think in many cases some of it relates to the messaging. Some people like the proactive nature of preparedness planning. Others really, if you're working in communities where there might be some concerns about whether climate change is an acceptable term, maybe risk reduction is a more acceptable label to put on those activities. But I wanted to point this out just so that you don't perhaps set aside some resources that talk about risk reduction or climate risk reduction and think that those may not be related to adaptation planning. So when we look at the process of adaptation planning, it generally starts with, it involves a series of steps that generally start with identifying your climate risks, so defining the problem, and moving through your identification of adaptation options or ways of dealing with those risks, implementation of those actions, monitoring, are those actions actually doing the things that you want them to do, and then evaluation and adjustments. So it is necessary to go back and revisit these actions that we're implementing. Are they being implemented in the ways, will they accomplish what you want them to accomplish? Are there new risks that are emerging? And to reevaluate where you are and to adjust your plan as needed. So I've put on this figure some of the common labels that are associated with these stages. So your vulnerability assessment is specifically geared at this defining the problem, so identifying those risks and identifying the adaptation actions that could be taken to address those risks, and then your adaptation plan is really selecting those actions and looking at how you may implement those actions. We've seen a lot in the area of vulnerability assessment and adaptation planning. The implementation stages are where things really start to slow down. That's where the tough work of adaptation planning really starts to begin. So I think that there's a lot of great examples out there for vulnerability assessment and adaptation plans. Those examples of implementation are really just starting to emerge. At its core, adaptation planning is answering what we call the climate question. How does climate change affect what I am trying to accomplish? It's a basic question, and it's a question that can fit at any scale, whether it is a specific project such as redesign of a bridge, or whether it is your whole community and in looking at your broader objectives for your community. And more specifically, it's asking, can we achieve our goals in a changing climate? How do we protect our investments as climate changes? This is particularly true with our infrastructure and with our habitat decisions, for example. What is necessary to reduce the risks associated with a changing climate? How do we avoid creating new risks? And what opportunities should we prepare for? There are certainly a lot of things about climate change that are negative, and even in the context of dealing with those negative impacts, there are still opportunities. There are opportunities for new partnerships, for example, or there may be opportunities for doing things differently that in the end not only deal with our climate risks, but could have other benefits as well. Now, when we start looking at adaptation actions, it's important to note that there are two different kinds of actions we're dealing with. I think the actions that many of us may think about and kind of immediately come to mind are things like levee setbacks or perhaps removing dikes to allow for coastal wetlands to move backwards or move back with sea level rise. Those are your implementation actions. But the other side of this is also looking at your organizational capacity, the capacity of your staff, of your department to access information about climate impacts, to access resources that will help with the interpretation of that information, and also to look at the barriers to implementation that may interfere with your ability to implement adaptation actions. So it's also looking at that organizational capacity. Now, we know that uncertainty is everywhere. We know that it's certainly brought up a lot when it comes to dealing with climate change. People will say, well, there's just too much uncertainty to act. And I think largely we are getting over that hump. I don't see that argument being put up as much as it used to be. But I think it's important to note that we have uncertainty everywhere. This is not a problem unique to climate change. And yet we still manage to make decisions. You know, we identify options, we build theories, we evaluate risk, we learn from experience, we rely on our experts, our local experts and peers. There are ways of managing that uncertainty. And when it comes to climate change and adaptation, there are some common strategies that, or kind of general groups of strategies, ways of talking about strategies that can help deal with uncertainty. And these may sound familiar, but one is to look for options that could be considered no regret strategies. So these are strategies that make sense to do with regards, with or without climate change. So there may be compelling reasons to implement an action. It will have adaptation benefits, but even if, for example, we're wrong about the magnitude of sea level rise. Let's say you plan an action around, for 24 inches of sea level rise and you see 12 inches of sea level rise. It's okay because you're still getting benefits from that. There's no regrets with that. Low regrets are strategies that might be done explicitly for climate change, for the purpose of addressing climate change, and there's little or additional cost or risks associated with that. So for example, if you're designing a piece of infrastructure and you want to increase the resilience of that piece of infrastructure to a particular climate impact, it may require modifying the design slightly. That could increase the cost slightly, but the increased resilience that you get makes sense. And then finally, there are these co-benefit strategies. So these are strategies that are implemented to help deal with climate risk, but in doing so also create other benefits that will either environmental, social, economic benefits that will be achieved as well in the course of reducing climate risks. In the course of working on adaptation planning, there are a set of guiding principles that I think are useful for thinking about the work that you're doing. And throughout the course of your effort, you want to be looking to increase public awareness of climate change and the projected impact. So it's really important for people to understand what you're doing and why you're doing it. You want to look to develop and maintain that technical capacity. So it is really that, again, going back to that organizational capacity, making sure that your organization is able to take in that information, access that information, and remove those barriers. You want to mainstream your information, so it's important that we don't have, you know, climate change work happening over here and all of our other things happening over here. Climate change affects so many of the issues that we're already dealing with on a day-to-day basis in our communities. And when you are over here working on stormwater management, you want to be thinking about how climate change is affecting that program, not saving it for a separate conversation down the road. You want to increase your adaptive capacity. Of course, that is the big goal in all of this. So as we're implementing these actions, we're always looking to make sure that we're increasing that resilience and the ability of our built natural and human systems to deal with these impacts. And then you want to strengthen those community partnerships. So there are so many impacts that transcend jurisdictional boundaries and or transcend the ability of one organization to tackle a particular adaptation action or a possible solution. So it's really important to draw on those partnerships that can be useful for implementation. Oh, that's my timer. It can be useful for implementation, but also, you know, for knowledge sharing. So we've seen a lot of partnerships develop around doing analyses that are of common interest to multiple groups, for example. So lots of opportunities for partnerships. I also want to note that there's really no single prescribed way for adaptive planning. I have a stack of, you know, the photos just a stack of cookbooks. And the point is that there's no one recipe for lasagna. There's no one recipe for reducing your climate risk. These adaptation is local. It is context specific to your place, to your community priorities, to the nature of your organization, to the resources that you have on hand. There are major milestones that will be similar. That schematic showing the different steps of problem identification and monitoring and evaluation. Those are all, you know, very common elements, but the flavor of each one of those is going to be unique. And you want to become familiar with the concepts, but don't be hung up on copying exactly what you see in someone else's plan. You don't have to do it exactly that way. You need to do it in a way that fits with your community. And then, as I mentioned earlier, there are lots of problems associated with climate change, but there are some opportunities as well. In some cases, they may be economic opportunities. For example, shifts in agriculture, there may be, you know, an opportunity to start growing new crops. But then there's also those opportunities that come through new partnerships and partnership building and new relations within the community around issues. Most importantly, as implied by that circular diagram, adaptation is not one activity or decision, but a continuous set of activities. So absolutely, this is not a situation where you develop your adaptation plan and you check that box, you're done, you put it on the shelf, you implement a few actions and you're adapted to climate change. We know that climate change is an evolving process. We also know that our communities are evolving and are changing over time. So there's this need to continually, you don't have to do it every year per se, but perhaps every few years, every 4 years, 5 years, you need to revisit that adaptation plan and ask, is this still the direction that we want to go with our adaptation planning effort, with our risk reduction efforts, or do we need to adjust based on either new science, new community priorities, or new opportunities that have come along to help with those adaptation efforts? And with that, I certainly welcome you to contact the Climate Impacts Group. We have an adaptation guidebook that we produced in 2007 that's available online, and I can certainly point you to lots of other resources that are also available to help with the adaptation planning process, the vulnerability assessment process. So don't hesitate to ask. Thanks.
We have time for a few questions for Laura before we move on to the next speaker.
Thanks, Laura. Good stuff. Very important. And a Some mitigation policies fall somewhere in that lower risk category of for example, if you look at probably the most effective examples of emission reduction policy, they also drive economic growth and they reduce the cost of energy. It's sort of not what we expect what they do. It's actually compared to the money. Would that count in this system, or is that just out of scope?
No, I think that hierarchy of no regrets, low regrets, it applies to those mitigation actions as well. And I think that you're right that there is some overlap between mitigation and adaptation actions. There's also the potential through your adaptation actions to be maladaptive and to create, to implement choices that could drive up greenhouse gas emissions. So that is an important issue to think about as you select your adaptation options, is whether that in itself is adding to the problem of climate change. But you're right there, and that hierarchy works from mitigation as well, and those are, in reducing greenhouse gases is in some ways an adaptive action. I mean, it is part of reducing our risks. It is part of that portfolio of reducing our climate risk, because you're not going to reduce those risks unless we take our foot off the gas pedal, literally and figuratively. But it's that, you know, it's those rising greenhouse gas emissions that are causing this acceleration of the problem. So part of that adaptation strategy would be reducing those greenhouse gas emissions.
I was noticing your statement that this is a one-time on the shelf activity. It's continuous activity. It sounds a lot like things like adaptive management we often talk about and rarely do. I'm kind of wondering what the, you know, kind of see an example of social institutional structures that allow us to do things continuously and adapt this kind of way that fits as well.
Well, I think that is, so, you know, King County has a climate plan. They have both an action plan that deals with mitigation as well as adaptation, and they're updating that, I think, every 2 years. So they have built into kind of their organizational expectations that they're going to revisit this plan and continue working away at this. The City of Olympia has an annual work plan to focus on some of the issues that they want to deal with climate change, and that's where they are looking at this as just something they're expected to work on an annual basis. So they set out their annual work objectives, and every year Andy Haub has to go back to Olympia City Council and report the progress he's made on those actions. So there are different ways of kind of institutionalizing that process of revisiting and updating your actions. I think the other part of this, though, is again getting it integrated into those ongoing decision frameworks that you're already relying on or already having to do on a regular basis. So it's a matter of bringing that in, bringing climate change and adaptation work into the fold of those ongoing activities, but and in doing so, also looking to see if there's anything that's falling through the cracks and may need some extra attention.
Okay, thanks, Laura. And please note, everyone, it's Laura, not Laura.
I don't know who's next.
So up next we have Hansi Halls, and I can't. Oh, that's not Mark's. I mean, that's Mark's.
I'll bring it up.
Okay, thank you. I can't multitask like that. So Hansi is the environmental planning manager for the Jamestown Tsklallam tribe. So now you get to hear an example of somebody who's actually been working on climate adaptation for a while. She has a master's degree from University of New Hampshire, and since that time has been in the Northwest. She's worked for the Jamestown tribe for 17 years, and her primary work has been related to water quality and salmon recovery, but she was also the project manager for the tribe's climate change vulnerability assessment and adaptation plan in 2013. And she loves being in the Olympic Mountains, where she is seeing climate change firsthand.
Good morning. I have a lot of photographs, so I'm actually going to turn off this light bar. See if that's an improvement. Well, thank you for having me, and I'm just here to tell the Jamestown tribes, can you hear me? Is that better? Okay. Thank you for having me, and I'm here to tell the Jamestown tribes story on our climate change work to date. We did this study and just focusing on sea level rise. So Jamestown's Gollum Tribe is a coastal tribe on the North Olympic Peninsula. The Dungeness Watershed is the ancestral watershed of the Jamestown's Gollum people. The usual and accustomed area extend from Nia Bay into Hood Canal. And we have a primary focus area in the eastern Strait of Juan de Fuca. And my job and my colleagues in the Natural Resources Department is to work on the protection and restoration of treaty resources. There's a lot of focus on marine resources because it's a coastal people. So the shellfish and the finfish, particularly salmon. And in the Natural Resources Department, we had some familiarity with the climate change models, but we had no expertise. And really what we wanted to do was say to the tribe, we see climate change impacts affecting treaty resources. So we started a conversation with the Natural Resources Committee and the Tribal Council, and we knew sort of just enough to say global carbon dioxide concentrations are going up, and correspondingly, global air temperatures are going up. Oops, sorry. And it took a little bit, you know? I mean, this was probably a series of four or five conversations, but we recognized vulnerability for the tribe, and we got the go-ahead to do the plan that Ian shared a little bit of yesterday. We hired Adaptation International to provide that technical expertise that we lacked ourselves and to translate these models and general regional information into the focus area of Jamestown Tribe. So I put this slide up just to show it was a big group of folks. You know, we had the technical consultants, of which Ian was one, but we included the tribal community, their commercial fishers and elder tribal citizens, as well as the department directors of all of the Jamestown staff, and that felt like a critical thing to do, to include facilities, transportation planning, that sort of thing. And when we got together on our workshop, we all were sort of like deer in the headlights. Nobody felt like they really knew anything and didn't feel as though we could author a plan. We were hoping to hire the consultant team. But they did this great warm-up of, you know, what do you know? What have you seen? And because it's a tribal community and staff that have been there for quite a while, we have seen changes. And with those changes, we're moving to sea level rise, and flooding has been seen, and intermittent flooding. So the consultant team began with, you know, for the sea level rise part, and Ian explained this yesterday, first they needed to correct for the vertical land movement. What's this body of land going to be doing relative to sea level rise? And they selected three GPS stations. This is one of them in Blinn, which is where the Jamestown campus is. And you can see it was installed in 2001. They selected two other stations which were about the same age. So the age for the vertical land movement adjustment, it's not that long, but it's apparently the best that they had. And then they took the results from the models that are out there, which have changed since then. This is 2012 projection information, and saying, okay, well, if as a society we make improvements and we have reductions, this is what we might expect. If we have a more modest reduction, here's our trajectory. And finally, if we have that business as usual model. So what does that translate to? About 8 tenths of a foot in 2040, about 2 feet over the next almost 40 years, and that extreme example, which is just over 5 feet at 2100, or 85 years from now. So the tribe, it's a coastal tribe, and we have infrastructure down low. This is the mouth of Squim Bay, where the reservation is, which is non-residential. It's the administrative campus. We have wastewater holding tanks that are, I don't know, about 11 feet above sea level. We have a dental clinic that's about 18 feet above sea level. So it's above that 5 foot worst case, but that's just where the new tide level is. That's not bringing into account the storm surge. So we know we have vulnerability on the campus. Correspondingly, we have the economic engines for all of the social services of the tribes, the casino and longhouse market,
right here, also at the mouth of Squim Bay. Same thing, they're not in that 5-foot level, but there's vulnerability. The transportation corridor was recognized as vulnerable, and Washington State Department of Transportation has the Squim Bay part of Highway 101 as a moderate ranking in their, I think it was a 2012 report. And Highway 101 going through Discovery Bay, which is a little bit east of Squim Bay and sort of the main access point for getting onto the North Olympic Peninsula and off, is lower. And that's considered a severe vulnerability by Washington State Department of Transportation. We have a small community of Jamestown citizens and non-tribal citizens. It's all privately owned. It's not a reservation. Folks just bought their land there as a community, as the Jamestown tribe, and some have sold, and so there's some non-tribal folks there. So the Jamestown Beach, we see vulnerability. There's a well that serves 20 tribal homes and 4 non-tribal homes. We're worried about saltwater intrusion. We're also worried about overtopping and saltwater vulnerability from the surface. This area is a little bit higher. I mean, you can see it's low bank, but there's a road, and these lots are those kind of spaghetti lots where people have narrow frontage, but they go long and back. So there's a little bit of room to maneuver. There are cultural resources of importance, including a cemetery here. But probably what I think about most in the natural resources is that charge to protect and restore treaty resources. And with that's another residential area a little bit west of that Jamestown Beach. It's called Three Crabs. And I can't tell you how much time I spend thinking about Three Crabs. It's built on a former sand spit. And if we look at the sea level rise projections from the consultant team, with that 0.8 foot, we see in 25 years what our flood risk is here. And then if we were to go in time, sort of 85 years into the future, which is maybe what people think their home will be, we're looking at a different shoreline. We're just really looking at an entirely changed landscape. And interestingly, this is the projections from the 2012 work that was published in 2013. And then Ian and that team did another project, which was published in 2015. And it's similar, but they have updated models, and they also updated the expression of those models. And so Ian talked about the probabilities and the probabilistic curve. So, and I'm bringing this into really kind of short term, right? 2030, that's not a long time away. So we're looking at 25% chance once we incorporate that coastal storm event, that extreme storm event, and sort of having the rebound from the low barometric pressure. And I think you probably remember what's under that 25% sort of blue curve was all of those homes. And here are some of those homes on that road, Three Crabs. And so they experience it now. They experience waves. They experience erosion. We're expecting an increase in what's considered intermittent flooding. And this is Three Crabs Road also. And then the response, right? So this is a series of 4 homes that got together just this last year. They'd noticed that king tides seem higher. Some of them have been on site for almost 2 decades, and they thought the king tides are just reaching their front decks, and so they all went together, and they did. This is actually going to be, it's sort of a hybrid of hard armoring and soft armoring. It's being buried. And then in my work, in my charge for protecting shellfish and finfish, I think about these little guys. Right, and the high energy that's now created when there's armoring that folks have put up to protect their home or their investment. And they're really little. I wanted to put this slide out here so we could think about that increased energy and the vulnerability of these little guys who try to get out of the deep water to avoid predation and stay in the shallows. And if those shallows are taken away, then their migration is just that much more challenging. I also spend a lot of time thinking about shellfish. Probably this is new to some of this group, but shellfish, if you're going to commercially harvest shellfish, the State Department of Health needs to approve your shellfish grounds, and they do that by monitoring fecal coliform. And if your fecal coliform's too high, then your shellfish beds are restricted in some way. There's classifications. And Indigenous Bay, which is, you know, this ancestral ground for shellfishing for Jamestown Tribe, in the mid-2000s, we essentially had all of those acres, and those are, that represents a couple thousand acres, were all downgraded. And we did a lot of homework to figure out why. And we recognized that failing septic systems were a big part of the problem. There were 53 systems of, and these are sort of the direct discharge repairs that were done. But septic systems are, they can't be saturated. And so when we have that intermittent flooding, sometimes environmental health needs to tag folks and tell them to not use their septic for a little while. That's hard, right? If you live in a home and somebody says, don't use your septic, what do you do? But we did a number of repairs together with other work. It wasn't just the septics, but the septics are known to be a big part of it. And we had this great upgrade, right? Puget Sound Partnership just in October came and did a celebration. It's terrific news, but we're faced with recognizing that we still have all these residences, and this one area is along Three Crabs Road. It's a small slough that's called the Golden Sand Slough. It was probably salt marsh, I don't know how long ago, maybe 65 years ago, something like that, and since then it's been built up. And we know already in this area, I know of 9 parcels that are having challenges to their septics at this moment, even without this increased inundation. And so what does that mean to the shellfish? If we have bacteria out there, then we get these downgrades. If we have increased nutrients, which none of the septics are really designed to remove nitrogen or contaminants of emerging concern, pharmaceuticals. Probably everybody's been following the salmon on drugs, you know, happy fish with Prozac. It's problematic. We've had increased numbers of harmful algae blooms. We're expecting that that's partly this nitrogen input from septic systems, and of course the closures that I alluded to before. And we have reduced access to shellfish for both subsistence and commercial that directly impacts tribal citizens. So the commercial market declines, there's economic losses. And then if the diet is changed, if people can't eat the nourishing shellfish, then it's likely to be substituted by something that is less nourishing for their body. And finally, when we did this planning, the folks from the health community said that shellfish gathering is a primary physical activity of many of the tribal citizens. And so if they're not out on the shellfish beds moving, then it's much more likely to be a sedentary lifestyle in the future. And together with all of that, we're concerned about the physical habitat. It's a sea or a land of many sand spits, the Dungeness Spit being sort of the biggest and grandest of them all, extending about 5 miles into the Strait of Juan de Fuca. Oh, and I just should have highlighted the sediment plume in this one. And then the sediment moving off. Because that's what builds the spit, is sediment coming from feeder bluffs. In this case, from the west is where the drift cell is. So the sediment peels off the bluff. Jamestown staff have done a lot of research into what that erosion rate looks like, kind of measuring back from historic photos and calculating that rate as about 1 foot a year. It's, of course, episodic, but they went way back in time and so have that good estimate. And some of it is developed. And so when people respond to an increased risk, they may or may not actually reduce their vulnerability, but they'll most certainly reduce the sediment input. And so we have this grand spit and its associated complex. And please just try to pay attention to Klein spit, that smaller one that's just projecting straight north. And so if we remove that sediment recruitment, you know, what might it look like? Could it be reduced to something this small? And what are the implications for our habitat? So it seems like maybe that's a little bit far-fetched, but I tried to ask you to pay attention to Kleinspit. And this is a real change that we've already seen. The mouth of the river has changed a little bit. And that Three Crabs neighborhood, which extends in the drift cell of the Kleinspit, has had a lot of armoring. And so this is a change, and it's a big change. You know, that's a 700-foot opening, plus or minus, that hasn't healed itself. We sometimes see breaches in the bigger Dungeness bit, but it tends to mend itself with sediment recruitment. But if that sediment's gone, it can't mend. So the tribe's done a lot of conservation planning work. There's a partner with the land trust and also with the county to try to implement sort of parcel by parcel prioritization for conserving and protecting that drift cell. There's a companion document for Squim Bay, same thing, just kind of looking at the erosion rates and then going through a parcel by parcel conservation strategy. And we're trying hard to promote those conservation strategies. We're trying to talk about our vulnerability and adaptation plan and to share the results. This quote here is from the tribal chair, just saying, one action that we can do now is to incorporate sea level rise and storm surge predictions into the Shoreline Master Program. So the tribe shared our sea level rise mapping, thank you to the consultant team, with Clallam County, and I'll talk about the results of sharing that data with them. But I have an example, because sometimes we think that we've just inherited all these legacy impacts and that these are sort of old stories and we're doing business differently from this point forward. But here's just a case example from, sorry, you guys, I forgot to say one thing that I really wanted to say here that brings this case example up. There's a for sale sign on the lower photo, which is on Three Crabs Road, and then the upper one says Cabins to Castles, which is something we see all over Puget Sound, but we definitely see in Clallam County where people purchase these small, modest camps or homes, and then they turn them into kind of a retirement home. And so this is an example of that, the project site here on Three Crabs Road. You can see how wet it is, right? Like it's a sand spit. And this was the structure that was purchased in 2012 with a building design that was submitted to Clallam County. Gosh, I'm a little bit nervous. Jamestown Tribe appealed that. We didn't want to see a building permit go there. They needed to do a shoreline exemption, but we did not prevail, and they put in armoring, and they built their home. And that's accurate. That's 17 feet from what had been no armoring at all, right? That was low bank in 2012, unprotected, and 2013, a home went up. That's the higher home in these two photos, the brown one that says built in 2013. It might feel like that's an exception, but the lower one, same neighborhood, built in 2014. And about 3 weeks before this presentation, I drove that road and I saw two other foundations. So it's real, it's still happening, and all of these guys, you can see these are nice homes. People have put in a substantial investment, and they have that probability of extreme flooding on an intermittent basis, about a 25% chance in 2030. So I'm expecting that they're hoping that their lifespan of their home is longer than that, but this is where we're sort of seeing conflict. So I have one hopeful story to share. Jamestown Tribe purchased property adjacent to our administrative campus. There's an existing structure on it, and so you can remodel, you can rebuild from existing structures, and that was the intention of the tribe when they purchased the property. We had storage needs. And Natural Resources looked at it and thought, oh my gosh, look at how close it is to the ordinary high water mark. Look at how close it is to high tide. And administration folks were like, yeah, we know, but, you know, we can do it. Legally, we can do it. And so we pulled in information from the sea level rise mapping and said, well, look over time what we'll see. And you tell us whether this is, you know, the investment that you want to make. And I think that being able to show this in this very visual way was a really compelling story. And the tribe ultimately left that property. They demolished that structure that was there, and it's a vacant lot that's just got native vegetation on it now. And they put the bus barn up. You can see Squim Bay just kind of through that little bit. It's perhaps a quarter of a mile away from the bay, and maybe 150 feet or 200 feet high. It's considerably higher. So I've pulled this slide from Nancy Lee's social marketing work. She did this great report on armoring, and her whole expertise is people and sort of social science and who who's willing to change behavior. So in that example of the tribe not making a new problem for itself, perhaps we're considered in that innovators, the ones who, with the information, if you're able to be shown, you can be compelled to a different behavior. And what I'm trying to do is think about how to sort of move into the rest of that bell curve with the early adopters and then the full majority. And somebody in our audience today helped Jamestown Tribe with a project, actually a couple. Ian Miller and Nicole Fagan worked with students from the University of Washington, and they did a fantastic report thinking about how to get that early adopters and that sort of majority of people to feel motivated to have a change. And they came up with a toolkit of things and methods to communicate. And here's just a visualization. I think Natural Resources staff had such great results in our visualization with the administration folks. We were just wondering if we could have the same with neighborhood folks. But one of the biggest questions is who would the messenger be, if it would be appropriate for the tribe or more appropriate for a different messenger. And then also on that sort of innovator curve is governments, right? Like, can governments do the best thing kind of early and model what is needed? So I mentioned that the tribe put in a recommendation to Clown County and their Shoreline Master Program update to incorporate sea level rise projections. We weren't the only ones. Thank you to the group that Ian is part of and the whole North Olympic Peninsula study. Quite a lot of people were aware of those changes that are expected. And so a lot of comments went into Clown County saying, let's be proactive and think ahead. And Clown County wrote to Department of Ecology. Their update is, it's open now. It probably should have been done already, but it's not been finished. And they wrote to Ecology saying, gosh, in our comment period, people are asking us to incorporate sea level rise. Please provide some guidance. And Ecology felt, I think, a little at a loss and said, well, we don't actually have any direction for you, and your Shoreline Master Program update, it's overdue. So why don't you just, you don't have to do anything. Why don't you just, I haven't read the letter, but this is what I understand the letter said, is tidy up, finish your project now, and we'll move toward that soon. You know, that's something we're aware, it should be done, but we're not gonna ask you to do that now. We have kind of a similar result with FEMA. They've just done coastal risk mapping of almost all of the shoreline of interest of Jamestown Tribe. Same thing, they produce their maps and they have the base flood elevation for today and the 100-year risk from that. And when asked about sea level rise, they said, oh yes, well, we also have available the 100-year plus 1 foot, 100-year plus 3 feet, and 100-year plus 5 feet. So the community can use that as they wish. And I said, well, do you have a recommendation? Like, will you give some direction to the community? And they said, no, we've stopped short of actually providing any clear recommendation. So that's some of the hurdles that we're facing. You know, jurisdictionally, we don't we don't have jurisdiction over some of the decisions that are being made. Some of the social conflict that we talked about before, where folks have their investments right in the same place where we see treaty resources coming to harm. And then, of course, what everybody is already aware of is just how are we going to pay for this work that's coming down the pipeline? So the tribe is trying to do their part in the mitigation part of it. As a follow along to our planning document, the tribe decided to do an emissions inventory. And the first one was done in 2012, planning on doing a second one in 2017. And I'd like to see it as a 5-year interval. We're taking as many actions as we can to improve resiliency for the treaty resources. Salmon restoration, land protection, what we can do. That's pretty much the story for sea level rise, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Hansi. Time for questions.
Absolutely. I didn't hear a question, but I agree. Actually, a colleague of mine is.
So the question was why we moved to the cross section when we were talking with the folks who were sponsoring the storage building and where it should be located. And actually, a colleague of mine, Randy Johnson, is really good at presenting information in a way that folks will understand it. And I think it was his suggestion. And I think it's even his rendering. I'm not quite sure. But yeah. Josh? Well, Laura's welcome to speak to you. I just would like to say, I'm not a climate change person at all. I do I do grant management, really, is what I do. And I have a full-time job doing that. And so it felt like, how could we begin to take this on? But we need to, and so we'll just start and see where it goes. And hopefully you see it's gone somewhere, right? Like we, just sort of taking on the small bite that we could, it's become not a full program, but there is work and it started. And so I think my biggest take home is whatever small step you can take, go ahead and do that. And it will build on itself because it's so important. Yeah, Jamestown Tsleil-Waututh Tribal Council definitely feels like they are very much on a community and cooperative basis with the community governments. It is a very friendly relationship, but not all decisions definitely seem to have treaty resources in mind. Sometimes we give opinion or comment and it's incorporated, and sometimes we do and it's denied. We have prevailed on some permit comments, and more often we don't prevail. And it takes a lot of resources to sort of chime in with comments and show up at hearings and stuff. So you have to be kind of choosy as to when you're gonna speak up. But for some of those, we felt we really had to, yeah. Uh-huh. And that's fine, and I think it's why I put our primary focus area, because the usual and accustomed areas are, that's mapped from the treaty, and then I wanted to just show our primary focus area of where Jamestown Tsleil-Waututh Tribe has a primary interest. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Hansi. Thanks. Yeah, great. So we may have a little bit of time at the end for more questions if you think of further wrap up. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Mark Lebhart, who's for almost 12 years has been a county commissioner in Tillamook County, Oregon. Before that, he spent 34 years with the Oregon Department of Forestry, and I left the notes over there, but he's also on a whole ton of other boards and commissions, and he just seems to love to volunteer. So Mark, and I have to say that I heard about Mark through colleagues at OSU about just what a great participant he was in a project that they had out in Tillamook County. So now we get to hear about that. Thank you, Mark.
Well, good morning. First of all, I want to thank the tribe for sponsoring this discussion. You never start off a talk with an apology, but I'm going to do that. I'm going to apologize to some of you in this room because I'm going to scare you a little bit. But I want to scare you because it is, in fact, reality, what I'm going to talk about. But I don't want you to be scared because also, the ending of my presentation, I want to talk to you about what we're doing about being scared. And I'm not only going to talk about climate change, I'm going to talk about what I think is the elephant in the room, and you'll see it when I get to that point. So I've been asked to cover three questions: how Tillamook County has experienced coastal hazards, both past and present. dealing with chronic hazards reactively versus proactively in the Neskowin area. And Neskowin is a small community west of Salem on the Pacific Ocean. The governor has a place there, Secretary of State, college president. It's a high-end community. Lots of political issues there. Possible insight on integrating science, particularly those with a wide range of future projections, into policy and decision making. So this is coastal erosion that's occurring in the community of Neskowin. This is a December 2015 presidential declaration that occurred in Tillamook County, Oregon, from coastal flooding and erosion. This is the little Tillamook Valley. There's about 5,000 people that live in this valley. The Tillamook cheese factory is in this valley, a lot of businesses. This is some of the flooding that we had. This is an example of coastal erosion that's currently happening in the Neskowin area. Those homes up there above there, in the $750,000 to $1 million range, and they're starting to get a little erosion on the toe of the slope there. So they said, well, let's go ahead and fix that. They put about $250,000 into this effort. So there's the erosion. And there's this, repairs are getting started. Big bucks coming into this. Repairs are about finished. There's a lot of money going into that to protect those homes up there. And the repairs failed. Coastal erosion comes back. This is fairly typical along the Oregon coast, and I'm sure along the Washington coast in some areas too. So today's population in the little community of Neskowin is about 200 full-time residents, and in the summer it just swells. About 20% of the people live there full-time, 70% of the people are second homeowners, mainly from the Willamette Valley, Portland area, that come to spend their summers on the beautiful Oregon coast. So this is a motel. This is some of the waves that are coming up a little creek called Hawk Creek. Now, I want to show a 15-second video. And not quite yet, but I'm gonna show this video twice. And the reason I'm gonna show it twice is because you're gonna see it the first time, and you're gonna go, whoa. So this is we don't even call them king tides anymore. It's a normal tide. This is storm surge that's coming up this little creek, and it's going to hit this bridge. This bridge is the only bridge in and out of the community of Neskowin. Hanging on that bridge is the water line and the sewer line for the entire community. So let's show the video here, and then we'll play it again.
Oops. Sorry.
It's not showing on the screen.
Oh, no. Oh, that did not work. All right, so we're not gonna be able to get that to work then.
Oh,
I'm sorry. We tried this beforehand, but it was because of the screen setup. Yeah, it's working here. It looks great here.
Okay.
I don't see any way to. Sorry. All right, well, I'm sorry about that. I'm happy to show people later.
Okay. So I'm gonna show you this is the end result of the video. So what happened was the bridge is right there. You can see the gentleman in the middle of the bridge. This is the storm surge that comes up and hits this bridge, and it just shows you, it just comes up, keeps coming up, goes back, comes back up, goes back, and it just inundates this bridge. This is what's left after the storm surge comes in. It brings in debris from the ocean, washes these large stumps up. That's a motel right across there. There's a little cafe there, but this is what happens. So we bring in county crews, and we attempt to remove it. So this is one of our papers, the Salem Statesman Journal, Coastal Towns Rethink Erosion. We're losing portions of our beaches to walk on. The little community of Neskowin is riprapped, from one end of the community to the other, in an effort for the community to try to protect itself from coastal erosion. It is a losing battle, folks, for this little community, and it's a losing battle along a lot of the Oregon coast right now. So property owners are spending big bucks. We had a large community in Cape Mears, which is west of Tillamook. In 1997, the local homeowners built multi-million-dollar condominiums right on the slope of the ocean, trying to be as close as possible, want to have that great view of the beautiful Pacific. And of course, the lawns dropped vertically 18 inches in January of 98. 5 more feet of drop were added a few weeks later. The main area boom was 900 feet long, 500 feet wide. We red tagged. And I'm an elected official, and you have to come in, and as another county commissioner in this room might know, and you have to come in and tell homeowners you can't live in your home anymore, and you red tag them. That's a pretty serious issue. The Department of Geology and Mineral Industries said the community experiencing high landslide potential from El Nino. Residents were evacuated and short-term mitigation was implemented. Long-term mitigation options need to accommodate coastal building regulations. We're still being evaluated. Notice the date there, 1997, 98, and then the 2000 report. So the question is, what are you as elected officials, what are you as governmental leaders going to do about coastal erosion? And that's what I'm going to get to in a minute. So lessons learned from the Capes disaster, better inventories and mapping of hazards along the Oregon coast, lesson learned, we need more objective methodology of coastal construction setbacks. We had dueling geologists. One geologist said, hey, you can go ahead and build those multi-million dollar condos there. We're not going to have coastal erosion. Another geologist says, nope, that's terrible. You shouldn't be doing that. So you have the dueling geologists that go on. Ensuring that developers and experts are accountable financially for any significant offsets. Because the homeowner said, well, what about the developer? We're going to sue the developer for this. Well, no, we'll sue the county. No, we'll sue the state. Because you shouldn't have allowed this to happen in the first place. Improve procedures and standards for geotechnical site reports. That's a lesson that we learned very clearly. Requiring disclosure of known and potential hazards affecting the property to all potential buyers. You move here from California, you're looking for your beautiful home, and you come in and the realtor says, yeah, we got a great view property for you, and doesn't tell you anything about coastal erosion, doesn't tell you about setbacks, doesn't tell you about your house is potentially going to fall into the ocean. So this is a little road, another just west of Tillamook called Cape Mears. This is a county road, folks. This accesses a U.S. Fish and Wildlife area. It's called the Three Capes Scenic Area. It's got a lighthouse out there. It gets thousands of tourists a year. This road is sliding into the ocean. That's the entire area right there in this little community called Cape Mears. The picture was taken right there. That whole massive area is sliding into the ocean as a result of coastal erosion eating away the toe of the slope on the Pacific Ocean. Okay, now I'm going to move to the elephant in the room. And the elephant in the room is a subduction zone earthquake. A 9.0 subduction zone earthquake that is projected to rip from Northern California to British Columbia. So, Dr. Goldfinger from Oregon State University is a highly respected geologist. We've passed the 75% reoccurrence level. He estimates that we have a 30% chance of a magnitude 9 earthquake in the next 50 years. The presentation that was just given along the sand spit, you know, I just cringe when I see homes being built right on the front of the ocean. I just cringe. It could happen tomorrow, and it could be another 300 years, but we are well past the time for a subduction zone earthquake that's going to impact us all, and you think we got problems from coastal erosion. So here's what, if you read the New Yorker magazine, it said that, or at least Oregon said, we're toast. And they did a long interview. Earthquake will destroy a sizable portion of the coastal Northwest. The question is when. It will be the largest disaster in the United States history. When we rip from Northern California along the Oregon coast, along the Washington coast, and up to Vancouver Island, we're going to have big time problems. So this is the city of Japan before the tsunami and afterwards. This could be communities of Seaside, Cannon Beach, could be Long Beach. Anything that's on the coastal front, this is what it could look like. What's going to happen? The water systems are going to fail. Electrical systems are going to fail. Liquid fuel systems will fail. Road systems will fail. Ports will be damaged. Bridges will fall apart. This is the little community of Cannon Beach, which is west of Portland. It was hit by the tsunami from Alaska. The bridge was down here in the bottom of the picture, and it washed up to the top. There's three school districts that are all in the little community of Seaside that are all going to be wiped out by the tsunami. This is the, let's go to Washington here, since we're in the state of Washington. The estimated land square miles is 71,000. Population is about 6 million people. People exposed to the tsunami will be 50,000. Potential residents and damages, it's 507,000. Damaged structures. I'm just going to go deaths estimated 8,400, injuries 12,000, hospital evacuations, and look at all the building debris that we're going to have to get rid of. Okay, I made my point. Yeah, it's going to be bad. So we know coastal erosion is currently happening, appears to be increasing. We know that earthquakes and tsunamis will be the disaster of all disasters. We know we're going to have a disaster after the disaster because many of us will be on our own for a significant period of time. The Army's going to come, FEMA's going to come, the troops are going to come, but we're going to be on our own for a while because they can't get to you. They're not going to get out to the Olympic Peninsula because the roads are all going to be closed. There's no, your airports are going to be damaged. The Navy could come in from the ocean, but it's still going to be, you're going to be on your own for a while. So what are we doing about all this? So Dr. Goldfinger, here's what he said, and I really like this. Ultimately, zoning decisions and decisions about what risk class a building will fall under in the building of tsunami codes are local. These folks have life and death decisions to make. They need to know that that is the case and need to help them do the right things. As elected officials, I need to step up and do the right things. You as local leaders in your communities need to step up and do the right things. We currently have coastal erosion that's happening. We know that we have, with climate change, we're going to have increasing coastal erosion, and we know that eventually we're going to have an earthquake and tsunami that's going to make us go back to the Stone Age in some areas. So what are you doing about all that? So Oregon has implemented what we call the Resilience Plan. It's a plan that was designated by the governor to work together to implement the provisions. There's 130 provisions in the Oregon Resilience Plan. Then what we've done on a local basis is we've put together the Coastal Erosion Plan. Now this is an interesting perspective because the previous slide that you saw where it said show me, help me, regulate me, this is the way it works, I think. Government has a difficult time coming from the top down and telling local communities, we know what's best for you. We'll tell you how you can do this. But if you can get communities to step up to the plate, like the tribe did on the Olympic Peninsula, and said we need to address these issues, that's what the community of Nesquin did. They came to the local government and said, we have coastal erosion issues. We know climate change is going to affect us even more. We know we're going to have an earthquake and tsunami. We want you, as our local elected officials, to help us draft rules and regulations that still allow for development, but done in the right way. So it was bottom up, and so it was the communities that came in. So that's a lesson that if you don't hear anything I'm saying, that's how you get things done, is from the bottom up, not from the top down. We can regulate, we can put regulations in place, but you get a better result if you come from the bottom up. So let's talk about what happened here. So this plan deals specifically with coastal erosion. Many of the provisions could apply to future development along the Oregon coast in the event of an earthquake and tsunami. So we're not just thinking about coastal erosion. We're trying to think about, okay, we know we're going to have an issue in the future, so let's also address this at the same time. So we put ordinances in place. The Department of Land Conservation and Development, and that's our state agency, is considering using what we came up with as a template for the rest of the Oregon coast on future development along the Oregon coast. Highly political issue, folks. We're talking billions of dollars worth of development now and then potentially in the future. So highly controversial. So this plan, and I'm just going to paraphrase it very quickly and be glad to provide you a copy of it if you want, but it requires a certified engineering geologist to certify the safest site on the property for development. It requires that any structure be set back 50 times the annual erosion rate plus 20 feet, and it provides the ability to reduce the frontal setback by the right to accommodate this. I know that's a little confusing. Be glad to talk to you about it later if you so wish. It limits density to one single-family dwelling, regardless of the underlying zone on the ground. That means no two-family residence can be built. It requires that any land division, at least 1,500 square foot building pad, be provided outside of the inundation zone, and properties fully within the zone are not eligible for division. In other words, you can't partition it off into another property. Requires movable structure in the zone. What? We said that you can go ahead and build on that front, that oceanfront property, and you have to do the setback. But you can't build a slab on grade. You have to, if there's coastal erosion, then you have to have the ability to move that home backwards. And so we can do that. And we've got an elevation restrictions in there too. Requires that certified engineering geologists certify the development to be within acceptable level of risk. We are taking risk. Life is a risk. When you drive home, there's a risk. We're not saying no risk. We're just trying to reduce the risk. So So we want to provide guidance for minimal disturbance of the lot during development, allows staff the discretion to contract out a peer review of submitted report instances where the geologist report might be in question. In other words, the property owner is going to hire their own certified engineering geologist to come in and dispute your engineering geologist. And we're saying, well, okay, you're allowed to do that, but we can bring in another third party to break that tie. So nearly every bullet point here could be translated into tsunami planning. And I think we need to do that on the large Washington coast and Oregon coast and Northern California. We can't just talk about coastal erosion, climate change. We've got to start thinking about that elephant in the room that's out there. It needs to be clear that the tsunami inundation area is much larger and higher than elevation than the Nesquen coastal hazard zone. So we have more work to do. Our coastal inundation zones for tsunami planning is pretty scary. So we've got the similar maps that you have in Washington. These are LIDAR maps that show inundation zones and where we need to do this kind of planning. So what else are we doing? And I know I'm going through this fast, but I want to make sure I leave time for questions. We've developed sister county relationships with some other counties on the east side of Oregon so that when the west side gets trashed because of the earthquake and tsunami, these folks from our friends on the east side can come over and help us out, because we're going to be burning the candle at both ends. And so we've, the little community of Umatilla County, which is Pendleton, Oregon, we've got a relationship with them where they're going to send over public work staff and come over and help us out when we get in trouble. So we're developing these sister county relationships. These are the current counties in Oregon that are developing these relationships, so when the west side gets trashed, the east side can come help us out. The DLC, the Department of Land Conservation, has prepared some guidance to assist local governments. We've got some land use guide for the Oregon coastal communities. We've prepared by the Land Conservation and Development in April 2015. Our state agency has been a really good partner with our local governments, i.e. counties, providing grant resources to help us to accomplish what we're trying to do. Land guide that focuses on three areas: life, safety, and adequate tsunami evacuation areas, zoning limitations, encouraging some community facilities and uses to be located out of harm's way, and provides incentives, options for land use incentives to develop in a more resilient way. At the end, or maybe in our case, just the beginning. So that's my story. Questions, if you have any?
Thank you very much, Mark. I'm sure there are questions. Here's somebody who's actually done it. In the very back, Claire.
Thank you. The land use regulations we put into place, we knew that we were going to get appealed to, and in Oregon it's called the Land Use Board of Appeals. And of course the developers appealed those land use decisions right away, saying these are too onerous, you're restricting development. And so it was appealed to our Land Use Board of Appeals, and LUBA upheld us. So they said, you're okay with doing that. They can appeal to the Oregon Supreme Court. The developers chose not to do that, so it's law. So they can't sue, at least in Tillamook County. Now, the Department of Land Conservation and Development, like I said, is looking at using this as a template for the rest of the Oregon coast to say, what you did in Tillamook County, we want to consider doing for the rest of the Oregon coast for development. That will likely be appealed to the Land Use Board of Appeals, too. But at least we won on the first case with our LUBA appeal. So, yes, sir. Yep. How we got it going was the message I wanted to leave with you. It has to start from the ground up. We had, and I don't mean this in a negative way, but we had a lot of certified smart people in NESCOEN. We had professionals on our committee. It took us 3 years to develop the scenario that we had. We had the president of Linfield College on there. We had some state agency folks that were retired. We had some really, we had a coastal engineering geologist retired. We had a couple other professors that were retired. We had some really certified smart people that said, we think this is the only way to address this is we want you as local government to put restrictions on us. So that's how it worked. If we'd come in as the county and said, we think we know what's best for protecting you, we're gonna put some regulations in place, I almost guarantee you we wouldn't have got very far. But because the community came up, and then we went to our planning commission, and went to the Board of Commissioners, and we had three commissioners in our county. We have three commissioners of full-time general government commissioners, and they see the benefit of doing this to protect our citizens both now and into the future. So, yes, sir. Yes, we do have it all mapped out. In Oregon, and I don't know what it is in Washington, but we have three levels. We don't go to the total 9.0 earthquake, but we have the mapping that's done with the sea level rise that the university did, and it shows, you know, the same thing that shows in Washington, a small increase over a period of time. But what's scary is when you put in the tsunami inundation lines. We have an A, B, and C, and the C is it goes way in. Now, I want to make sure you know this. Our rules and regulations don't cover all the way in. But we're taking baby steps. Eventually, we're going to have to put rules and regulations in to say, okay, if you want to develop, you got to do it in a certain way. You're going to have vertical elevation as well as setback elevation. And I can argue both sides of the issue. You know, you've got a vacant lot. That lot's been in my family for three generations. And we're now ready to build our home there. And you're telling me that I can't develop on that property that's been in my family for three generations and I paid $200,000 for that lot? You're telling me I can't do that? You let me build a home on the frontage of the ocean and that thing washed away? How stupid are you? I mean, don't you know as a government official that washed away? I mean, can't you figure this out? Why did you let those people build there? You know better. Yeah, welcome to our world, my world. No. Yes, sir. Short answer, yes. Long answer, we did not do it. But what's happening is we have conservation groups, the Nature Conservancy, the Trust for Public Lands, and what we call the North Coast Land Conservancy, that is currently in the process of looking at property that's along the coastal strip that could be put into preserves, nature preserves, and they're buying that up. And in the Tillamook Valley, we have, you know, we're the land of trees, cheese, and ocean breeze. That's what we call ourselves. So there are areas that are farmland, but they're marginal farmland, and those would be better in wetland restoration areas instead of development for farms and those kind of things. So the Nature Conservancy is working real close with our Creamery Association to acquire some of those farmlands and providing more area for these flood waters and coastal erosion waters and possibly earthquake to not allow development there. So there is some areas that are being purchased by some of these conservation groups with the support of the county. They do it in a collaborative way. They're not just coming in and buying up land. Did that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't get that. Oh yeah, we're definitely involved in that. Oh, most definitely, yeah. I sit on the governor's task force for implementing the resilience plan, so. Cascadia Rising is a project to work with our state emergency managers to deal with what's gonna happen when you have an earthquake, how to prepare for it, plan for it, and then the end results of it. We have right now, In Oregon, we have designated the city of Redmond, and Redmond is, of course, on the east side of the Cascades. It's got a major airport. That's where the Army and FEMA and all of those will be coming in, and then all the resources that will be coming into Western Oregon will come from Redmond, because we're already pretty sure that I-5 is going to be toast. We know Portland's going to have major issues, Salem, Eugene, and so we can't we can't put in any kind of planning along the west side of the Cascades. We're gonna move there. So we've been doing planning. Cascadia Rising is the planning effort to try to address some of these issues. But I can guarantee you, it's just not gonna work. We can plan forever, but it's gonna be literally, folks, the worst disaster our country has ever experienced. And so, but when the statement I use is pretty simple: don't be scared, be prepared. You need to, if you live along the coast, you need to prepare yourself to be on your own for a while. Don't be scared about it. Don't panic. We just need to be prepared to know that you're going to be on your own for a while. And I'm really scared. I am scared for communities along the coast. You know, the previous presentation about building that home right up next, and they got that little 3-foot berm there, you know, that they built, and they're thinking, well, that's going to help me with coastal erosion. That tsunami wave's going to go right over the top of that and wipe out that house, and it's going to be a mess. So we as government officials, we as local officials, need to start thinking about that and starting to try to address that, and don't stick our head in the sand. Yes. Good question. Yeah, we've been asked to put in a moratorium on building, and we've said, no, we don't want to do that. What we said is, we're going to allow building to continue, but we want it done in the right way. And that's what I mean by some of those restrictions. If you want to build on the coastal strip, and you want to build in this area, you've got to build it to these standards that we've put into place. Well, then we'll get the permit unless they meet the restrictions that we've put into place. We won't issue a building permit to them. County issues the building permits. Hold harmless? Well, you can always sue the county. But our rules and regulations have withstood an appeal process through what we call our Land Use Board of Appeals. So you can appeal it, but it won't go anywhere because the state's saying it is legal and it is law. So, I mean, but you could still try to sue us, but it probably won't go anywhere. So this is what I think needs to happen along the entire Oregon coast and the entire Washington coast, is we need to start moving in that direction. It's going to be a slow process because there's a lot of development along our coastal strips with coastal, and we've already experienced it. That's what I tried to show you with the pictures of Neskowin. They're already experiencing climate change in their community. It's here, it's happening now, and this community is smart enough to say we want to address it. We just need to have the fortitude as elected leaders to say we understand that and we need to start moving in that direction. It is going to be a long process, it's going to be a slow process, but we need to start moving in that direction. Our legislature is clearly on board with doing that. The hard part is, how long is it going to take, and what kind of rules and regulations do you put on folks to be able to implement this? That's going to be the hard part.
One more question and then we'll see the video.
Oh, you got it. Okay, good.
It's just so refreshing to hear a county commissioner like you here. But it seems like with that, there's a responsibility to share this with other counties and really.
Well, that's why I'm here. Yeah, that's a really good point. And we do not have a monitoring plan in place. I mean, we can show that by moving this house back 100 feet from the coastal shoreline and the erosion that happened, we can show that examples of, man, if we'd allowed that development right here, that house would be gone now. But that house is still there now, and those people are happy. There may not be, they got to walk 30 feet instead of, you know, but they still have their ocean view. So that's the only, but we do not have a monitoring plan in place. But we're trying to show it with pictures and, you know, just like those folks that had the very first slides that I showed you where the mountains coming down, if they'd have just put that back another 50 feet, they wouldn't have had to put $250,000 into that bank that failed anyway. And they still would have had their magnificent view of the Pacific Ocean. So, okay, so let's turn the light out here, because it's actually, it's pretty cool. Watch this wave come in. This is coming up Neskowin Creek right now. And there's the bridge, you see.
When was it shot?
Last year, December 15. Here it comes again, just keeps coming, just keeps going back and going. So everything to the left is the community. Now, can we show it one more time? Everything to the left is the community of Neskowin. This is the only way in and out of this community. And this is fairly common. They're sitting on the deck of this cafe right now and filming this. I don't know if I would have been standing there or not. Now, and I don't know if you can see it or not, but there's big root wads from the ocean that come in with this thing, and they bang against that bridge. And the water system, the sewer lines hanging on that bridge. And so, you know, that's a county bridge, by the way. So so we're trying to figure out a way to address that. I've been way over time.
Yep, thank you very much, Mark. We appreciate your being with us. And clearly, there were lots and lots of questions for you. So our last speaker in this session is Gwen Shaughnessy. She has a background in marine biology and non-traditional education. She works at NOAA's Office for Coastal Management, which she joined in February of 2011. Her current role is Climate Adaptation Specialist in the Training Engagement Program. So she's worked a lot with local communities, and we'll hear from Gwen.
All right, I'm gonna try to not yell into the mic. I tend to be really loud, so giving me a mic is dangerous. This is gonna be a hard act to follow. Those were two really great case studies that we heard. As Phil just mentioned, I work for NOAA's Office for Coastal Management, and part of my role within that is being the lead coordinator and national kind of trainer for a three-day adaptation training that we do nationwide and with our territories. I've been doing it for a little over 5 years, so I've had the pleasure of hearing a lot of stories from across the U.S., and that's going to help kind of, I guess, inform parts of what I'm going to be doing today for you all. I'll have a very short presentation. What I've been asked to do is come in and sort of be a bookend for the panel. So I'm going to try to kind of weave some threads, try to identify some commonalities, some differences, and hopefully plant some seeds as we head into our afternoon's open sessions again. So thinking about, you know, how do we capitalize on the opportunity of having all of these great people in the room for the last 2 days? What are some discussions that we still need to have in terms of, you know, identifying where we need to go with this discussion? So that's kind of where I'll start. This slide should look familiar. I stole this from Laura. Thanks, Laura. And I just wanted to pull this back up because I think it's a really important point, which is that although the adaptation process that she outlined, and I'll show that in just a second, is kind of a, you know, a typical problem-solving process that we all do, whether or not we think about it. We do it if we're trying to buy a car or a house or change jobs. We struggle with identifying what the issue is and what are some potential options for solving that issue or that problem. How do I know that the choice I made is the right choice? You know, we evaluate and monitor. So adaptation planning is not different than how we go about solving other issues. And in that, it takes a different shape and form based on where you go and who's sitting around the table and what are the main motivations for doing that work. And that, as Laura said, is very local. It's very entrenched in local values. It's very entrenched in local priorities and goals and the local issues. And so, as she mentioned, while the milestones will look very similar, how you get about doing that could be very different. And so, Fortunately or unfortunately, there's no silver bullet in adaptation work, right? There's no, I can't stand up here and say, these are the top five best things that you should do regardless of where you are, because that's gonna be very different. And I'll talk a little bit more about that as I go on. So give some thought to your recipe, right? We're all trying to cook a dish here, which is dealing with sea level rise, but what are the ingredients that we all need to bring to the table? And think about that in our afternoon discussions. You just heard two great case studies, as I mentioned, that had some similarities but some differences. And so I wanted to kind of use those as benchmarks for how I'm going to set up the rest of my talk. And I'll reflect back on some of the key points that I heard both Hansi and Mark make through their stories. And as I mentioned, I'm using this to kind of think about how we head into the afternoon. So as I'm talking, feel free to ask questions or jot down ideas for the open sessions that we're about to head into, because I think, if I'm not mistaken, Sono is somewhere in the back, we are going to be brainstorming what the agenda for the afternoon looks like before we go to lunch. And so I've been asked to kind of help set the stage for that. And so be thinking about some ideas that you want to have for discussions. So again, thinking about kind of getting back to the planning process and thinking about the sessions that we want to think about for this afternoon, do we need to have further conversations around this first step, which is defining the problem or understanding the issue, as I like to say it. And so, you know, just thinking back to, you know, the presentations that we just heard and thinking about the problem, one of the things that I've seen a lot of communities across the country struggle with is really identifying what the problem actually is. I know that sounds bizarre, and we're here talking about sea level rise, so it should be like, well, Gwen, duh, it's sea level rise, that's the problem. But I wanted to reflect on a comment that the gentleman made about kind of secondary impacts, and taking that a little bit in a different direction and maybe forcing you to think about it in a little different way, which is, although sea level rise might be the driving force of the issue, thinking about how that presents on particular landscapes and understanding that is really, there's some richness there, and it's going to help inform how you talk about what the solutions or interventions might be. And so in the case of Hansi's discussion around the Jamestown example, you know, they were looking at sea level rise, but they looked at it in a number of different facets. So it was the factor of having a mass of water now on the land, right? So having too much water on the land is a problem. They were also looking at the saltwater inundation, so thinking about water coming not just over the land but through the land and impairing septic systems. So that is a real problem. So sea level rise might be driving that, but understanding that mechanism is the true problem is going to help you then have conversations about potential solutions. The other one that she had mentioned was around water quality. Oftentimes we don't think about the connection of sea level rise and water quality and the impacts to shellfish beds. Or spawning areas, whatever it might be. And so thinking about, you know, sea level rise as maybe an issue, but then what does that actually mean on the landscape? How does that translate into real issues? You know, thinking about the Nesquin example, it was erosion was the real issue. And thinking about how sea level rise might further enhance or, you know, exacerbate that existing issue. But if they were simply just talking about sea level rise, they probably wouldn't have gotten to the ordinance that they did. So thinking about the specific problem that you're grappling with. And then thinking about something that I think Laura touched on, which is some priorities and identifying them right from the beginning. So thinking about, you know, our existing goals. What is it that drives the work that we do on a day-to-day basis? And what does sea level rise or climate change mean for those existing priorities and goals? How does that factor in? Are our priorities to protect what we have? Are we just trying to avoid creating new risks? And then this last one is around opportunities, and I'm going to take a little different spin on the opportunities that Laura set the stage for in thinking about looking ahead. And I think this is something that really struck me yesterday in hearing some of the tribal members talk, which is having a broader vision and thinking about what is it that we want. At the beginning of these conversations, what is our future? What do we want it to look like? Is it something better than what we have now? Or is it simply, it's going to be different, but we want at least as good as what we have now? So that's a little bit of a different conversation, and there's some visualization that needs to happen with that. You know, what is it that we ultimately are trying to get to? And work backwards from there. And what is the opportunity that we have in that? And so this is something that I've really had the pleasure of experiencing as an evolution over the last 5 years. So when I first started teaching the training class that I do, the conversation was very different. It was a lot about uncertainty. It was a lot about how do we use science in planning. It was a lot about, you know, do we even bother having this conversation if it's such a big problem, we can't possibly have an impact on the outcome, right? It was a very overwhelming conversation to have 5 years ago. And what I've seen evolve in the nature of the conversation is really more and more communities are not only recognizing that they have an opportunity to do something great and do something different, but they also have a responsibility to do it. And I think that just that change in dynamic in the conversation, we've seen so many more communities actually taking steps, whether it's instituting policies or doing vulnerability assessments, whatever it might be. And so just thinking about, you know, what are those opportunities? Maybe we have a discussion this afternoon about how do we start capitalizing on those or identifying those. So moving further into our process and thinking about, you know, do we want to share stories around where we are in the process in terms of, you know, are we at that stage of thinking about conducting vulnerability assessments? Do we need to do, a dedicated vulnerability assessment that Jamestown did, where they hired consultants, they pulled in some experts, they did mapping, they identified some specific resources or assets that were potentially at risk for those very specific impacts that we had just talked about. Or maybe it's just simply looking at mapping that already exists and trying to understand, you know, what is the data and modeling that we have already, and we're ready to start identifying some solutions. And thinking about, as we identify those solutions, figuring out what the trade-offs are. You know, if we make a certain decision in our course of action, what could potentially happen? Either benefits or potential maladaptations, as we've talked about. You know, what are the unintended consequences of some of our actions or inaction, as it might be? And thinking about how we tap into existing processes. What are, maybe it's the Shoreline Master Program that Jamestown had identified as the right mechanism for them to start thinking about incorporating sea level rise or climate change into. What are those policy venues that we can start integrating these discussions and decisions into that are already kind of ongoing, that we don't have to recreate the wheel? And then the last kind of slide that I'll leave with, I'll keep it brief because I want to get you guys thinking and talking, because I think that's really where the magic happens in these meetings. So is thinking about how we then create a roadmap. So we've been here for 2 days. We've had great conversations. We've had really great panelists that have shared not only their knowledge, but their experience and their lessons learned. What do we do with that information? Where can we take it after we leave here this afternoon? And so thinking about maybe designing some of the sessions this afternoon around just sharing where you are in the planning process. Maybe having a session around still understanding the issue. You know, what is it that we're still grappling with? Maybe it's a continuation of some of the sessions that we had yesterday. I know the two that I was involved with both ran long. So I ended up only hitting two because we had two that were about an hour and a half each. And so were there some sessions yesterday that we wanted to continue or keep going? And then thinking about, you know, if we are talking about those various steps along the planning wheel, if you will, how do we start moving from one to another? If the majority of us are still kind of in the understanding the issue or the problem phase, and we're trying to kind of move the needle or be early adopters and you know, thinking about that bell curve, you know, how do we get further down the spectrum? What is it that we collectively need in order to take those steps, to move through those wheels, to get to implementation and evaluation? Is it a capacity issue? And by capacity, you know, maybe it's thinking about, you know, Lara's slide that had the two kind of types of adaptation, you know, strategies that are out there, the kind of, you know, action-oriented one versus, hey, we still need to build institutional capacity. What is that? What does that mean? Is it staff resources? Is it capacity and understanding what the science or the models are? Is it simply knowing where to tap into specific sources of funding, whatever it might be? So thinking about the capacity issue, I had a chance to look through, I don't know if anybody else did, I was curious, so I looked through the responses that you guys provided as part of the registration process, where you identified your role in sea level rise planning and then some questions that you had. And I was delighted to see there were a number of people, maybe not delighted, but it was interesting to see that there were a number of comments there about people really struggling with how to communicate with various groups on this. Somebody had identified fishermen as a specific audience. And so just thinking about maybe we design some of our afternoon sessions around effective communication. How do we start engaging around this topic in an effective way, whether it's through the use of visuals like we saw with Jamestown, and what those visuals might look like? I think it was a really great comment that, or you know, awareness that people noticed that there was a profile version or the map version of looking at visuals, and just recognizing that not everybody can look at a map and understand what it means or interpret it or kind of get a sense of the true nature of that risk just by looking at, you know, an inundation layer on a map, unless you can start to understand what's underneath that map, you know, thinking about ways to effectively engage or communicate around this. And then the last one here is something that we heard, I think, through both of the case studies, which was thinking about opportunities for collaboration and partnership, and knowing that we're not in this alone. And so how can we use that to our advantage? How can we start building partnerships and relationships, or tapping into the ones that we already have that are functioning and that are helpful for us to kind of have this, if you will, this, you know, gain in efficiencies almost. So how can you start working together and across jurisdictions to move the needle? And so whether it's, you know, tribes and counties working together or scaling that up, you know, from the citizens all the way up to state government, whatever it might be. But thinking about, you know, how is it that you can better develop those relationships and sort of help each other out. And with that, hopefully I've planted some seeds for thought. I'm certainly happy to take questions. I know I didn't have a traditional presentation to share, but if there are, I think we've got time for questions, I think maybe for all of the panelists, if there are some, or we can head right into the sessions. I'm gonna step away from the mic. Maybe.
Two questions for Gwen. Yes. Do we have another mic somewhere?
What if your first step is you don't have common goals? If you're all assuming that you've got goals, and if everybody's got different
Okay, no, too late.
Did everybody hear the question? Common goals. What if you all have different goals? How do you get on the same page? Yeah, I think that speaks to part of what I was mentioning about, you know, communication and engagement. And if you're working with multiple groups, is right up front, having those conversations. I think that's part of understanding the issue and defining the problem is coming at the question of, you know, where are people coming at this from? What are the entry points and what are the motivations for what people are trying to accomplish? And oftentimes that takes some skilled facilitation to have some of those challenging conversations. But again, spending time up front with that, I think, is really important.
There was one in the very back.
So the bottom bullet, if we think about jurisdictional boundaries sort of across the country, there are, you know, typically when you see something like a sort of a national vulnerability assessment, the Pacific Northwest typically ranks lower than other parts of the country. And so that suggests that there are places around the country that are dealing with this potentially in with more of a sense of urgency even than we are. How do we tap into lessons learned from those communities or jurisdictions in other parts of the country that are also trying to sort of address this issue?
Yeah, so I'm gonna pull the like facilitation card out of my back pocket and turn it back on the group, because I will say that and maybe have a session around that this afternoon. And I do that, you know, kind of tongue in cheek, but to be serious, that is something that our office has really struggled with. You know, because we do have, you know, a national scope, and we do have regional offices throughout the country. And one of the things we struggle with even within our office is how do we share across regions within our staff, let alone with the partners that we are a part of. And so thinking about what are those effective ways, you know, I've heard yesterday that just simply sharing case studies may not be the best way to do that. Because if you don't have Mark up in front of the room to answer questions and you're simply reading, you know, a two-pager on a particular effort, you may not get the nuances. You may not get some of the fine, you know, between the lines efforts that happened. And so thinking about how do we foster that cross-organizational sharing. You know, there have been a number of clearinghouses out there that house case studies. For those of you that don't know, I think CakeX was one of the original ones through EcoAdapt. And it's massive. If you go on their website, it's so hard to find anything because there's so much on there now. And so if a database or a clearinghouse is not the best way to share this information, how can we do it other than in-person venues like this? How do we reach the masses? I don't necessarily have an answer, and I would be happy to sit in on that session, and Mark is chomping at the bit, so I'm going to let him talk.
So that's a really good question. Anybody from FEMA here? You? Okay, so did you sit in on the conference call yesterday with the DC on the Mitigation Framework Leadership Group? Okay, so I am the West Coast representative for the National Mitigation Framework Leadership Group, which is a group set up by the National Security Council, and we meet quarterly, and yesterday was our quarterly meeting, and one of the things that came out of on it was the, and it has all the federal agencies there, NOAA, Fish and Wildlife, you know, the Corps, all the agencies, and FEMA has agreed to do a nationwide vulnerability assessment. And they got direction yesterday to start working on that vulnerability assessment. They've got a bunch of information they've already prepared, but clearly all the states want this vulnerability assessment to be done. And so FEMA's taken the lead on putting that together. So you're gonna get an answer to your question. So.
Okay, thanks. So I think with that.
One more question, apparently. Somebody has the mic, so.
Right, we need to move on. Well, we're.
So one thought is that we have a lot of existing collaborative cross-jurisdictional structures and plans, some of them under salmon recovery, some of them under the Action Agenda and Puget Sound Partnership, some of them tribal conference related. So, you know, one thing for us to think about is not necessarily creating new roadmaps, but taking a look at already existing planning that has adaptive management in it and saying, how do we utilize those structures to work on this issue? Now, it's not going to cover everything, but that's something for us to think about.
Yeah, absolutely, and I think that's, I was trying to get there with my last little bullet here on the slide, so.
Okay, so we're going to take a break, and do you want everybody back? At-